Regulators of Georgia's Division of Equal Opportunity. I'll ask you to join me in a pledge to the flag and follow by the national anthem performed by the Barrow Community Band, directed by Joyce Keenan. At this time, rise and remain standing and ask Melvin to lead the invocation.
Thank you, Ken. Good evening, everyone. Good afternoon, I should say. Before we do this invocation, just meditate and thank God for two brave soldiers who fought a serious attempt to cause an attack on France. And because of the heroic efforts of those two U.S. soldiers, many men alive were saved. So as we go to God in prayer, thanking Him for our servicemen and women who serve in harm's way daily to protect the liberties and freedoms that we so richly enjoy. Let us pray. Father God, we humbly bow today to say thank you for beautiful weather and this great state of Georgia, her leadership, and this great nation and those that you have placed to guide her. With all of them, Father, let them be guided by your eternal light and vision and divine wisdom and knowledge, not by the polls or the pundit, but what is right according to your will. Father, we thank you for the men and women who serve in harm's way to protect the very liberties and freedoms that we so richly enjoy today. And for those who have paid the ultimate sacrifice, let us never forget that freedom is not free. Father, we thank you for this opportunity here in Wine and Barrel, and we thank you for the elected officials here and those that are campaigning to be like their Father. Give them the wisdom and courage to do what you would have them to do as they articulate the issues most important to them. And Father, while we respect what others believe, I choose to end my prayer in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Melvin. We've got the big flag on this end, a small one down there. Join me in the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag.
Enter the contest. As we go through the lines, we'll cut it off and we'll tessellate the
I do need to mention one thing. If there's anybody supporting Jim Gilmore for president, he is not on the ballot. You will have to add his name if you are supporting Jim Gilmore. I also want to ask you to do something because we're spread out. We've got three or four exhibit tables in here. We've got exhibit tables on the front. You've seen the tents on the sidewalk. Please go by every one of them and check them out. We appreciate them being with us today. Now, we need to dismiss some groups first to go through the line. If you're a speaker or a sponsor, if you'll take your groups and go through first because we need you to get through and eat and get ready to speak, and then we'll have everybody else go after that. Please be patient. We'll get everybody through as quickly as we can. We appreciate you being here. And while you're going through the line, we'll turn it over to the Argo Community Bank.
Sorry. Hey, Tom.
benefits dog catcher. Please stand up, and Republican Party officials, please stand up. We appreciate you as well. And I want to give special recognition, and I don't know where he is there, for Robinson. For Robinson, welcome back to the team. We appreciate Roy Robinson being with us. Every time we come down here, he recognizes me, and I want to give him this time. Also, we have with us Debbie McCord, State Party Second Vice Chair. Miss Debbie, please give a big round of applause, Debbie. And also, Ron Johnson, he is the under 80,000 County Chair Representative from the state of Tennessee, the best one we've ever had. Please give him a big round of applause. And it takes a team effort. All the people that volunteered to help put this together, would you please give them a big round of applause? And for all our sponsors and exhibitors, if you haven't had a chance to go by their tables or find these people, I'm going to call these all and just give applause all at one time. Our regular level sponsor this year is State Representative Terry England. We have Patriot level sponsors, State Representative Regina Quick, State Senator Frank Ginn, Barrow Commission Chairman Pat Brown, Smith Funeral Home, we found Smith, we appreciate you, State Representative Tom Kirby, Sheriff Doug Smith, Congressman Jody Hice, and we have some new sponsors this year, Wilkes County Republican Party Chairman Sidney Bounds, we appreciate you. We appreciate you as well. And also our Liberty Level sponsor, Alex Johnson and Advanced GOP. We appreciate you being a sponsor as well. Thank you very much. For our vendors and exhibitors, I want to recognize the conservative Republican women of Northeast Georgia. The Georgia Fair Tax Group. Where's Georgia Fair Tax? We appreciate them.
Visiting and catching up with the folks that you probably haven't seen in a good little while. I just want to tell you thank you for giving me a second to talk to you, and thank you for allowing me to represent you for the last 11 and a half years. And it's been a pleasure and a blessing for us. One of those things that sometimes you kind of like the dog catches the car, you wonder whether what you're going to do with it when you catch it. But we've had a good time and really been blessed being able to represent Barrow County, a place where Cindy and I both were born and raised and continue to live. Please feel free anytime that you need us to reach out to us. As I tell everybody, we're still in the phone book. And you can find us on the internet anywhere else. Frank will give you his cell phone number here in a minute. I'll be glad to give you my cell phone number too. But anyway, I just want to tell you thank you for allowing us the opportunity to be with you tonight. Thank you to Regina and Tom Kirby and Frank for being part of our delegation here in Barrow County and the great work that they do and just being part of our community as well. So thank y'all. God bless you. If we can ever help you, let us know. Thank y'all.
Thank you, Ginn, and good evening, everybody. Not so close. Fighting a little bit of a cold, but I wanted to just say thank y'all for coming out to support the party. And I am so honored to be able to represent Barrow County with Chairman England and Representative Kirby. Nobody really came here to hear me talk tonight, but I want to say a little bit about Jody. You know, Congressman Hice, I'm excited to hear him because I'm excited about what he's doing in Washington. And Jody, I want to just tell you personally, I don't know if y'all know, we communicate a lot, both during the session and when he's got tough votes up in Washington. And I just appreciate everything that you've done for me and the support that you've given. And I'm happy to serve with somebody who believes, as I do, that we are in a very serious time here, and if not now, when? And if not us, then who? And thank you again for letting me serve Barrow County, and enjoy the rest of your evening.
Well, good evening. Not so close. 2016 is definitely upon us, we know that. And what's it about? You go back September 17, 1787, it's the date we signed the Constitution. That's what 2016 is about. Back in 1787, we decided that we the people could govern ourselves. We didn't need a ruling class or a monarch or a king. But we the people, securing that blessing of liberty for ourselves and our posterity, that's what we're all fighting for. The DNC chairman didn't refuse to answer the question on what's the difference between the Democrat Party and the Socialist. She couldn't answer that question because there is no difference today. That's what we're fighting for from now till November in 2016. There's going to be at least 16 of our candidates that are not going to be our nominee. And if your candidate drops out, we need everybody on board. The math is simple. Had everybody who voted for John McCain voted for Mitt Romney, President Romney would be in the White House today. We've got to get off our seats, get our family, get our friends out there. If we're going to secure those blessings of liberty for ourselves and our posterity, it starts here today and goes all the way till November 2016. And we're there to help any way we can from the state of Georgia. Thank you.
We appreciate our local delegation for the hard work they do for us. They're very successful. If you ever have a question, give a warm welcome, Frankie.
Thank you, Gina. Ladies and gentlemen, I want y'all to know what a special night tonight is.
said, you know, there's a lot of folks that come to the barbecue and enjoy the barbecue and get to see a little bit of America in action. One of the things I want to introduce y'all to a new friend, found friend all the way across the ocean. And I'm going to ask, and I want everybody to understand, I can't speak Swedish or anything about Sweden. So I'm going to botch her name, but I want her to stand up. This young lady is from Sweden. She's a Georgia Rotary student over here at Georgia Gwinnett College. And her name is Tenila Ura. Said, and if anybody can say it better than I can, it's only her that I've been able to hear that from. Said, but I wanted y'all to welcome her to Barrow County. I wanted her to see a little bit of Georgia politics. And now let me introduce you to two special ladies in my life. My wife standing here in the back, if any of y'all know Robin, said, and I want to give her a big round of applause. And I want y'all to understand that in my house, I have a daughter that's 17, and there's boys coming around all the time. And I see problems with her, but my daughter Catherine and her friend Fran. Ladies and gentlemen, the best experience I've ever had is to get to be your citizen. And I don't care if you live here in Barrow County or if you just live in Georgia. I met some folks here tonight moved in from Texas. And I tell them, I said, look, I don't care where you live in Georgia, I'm your senator. As long as the folks in the 47th district give me the opportunity, we're here to serve the citizens of Georgia. I'm proud to be your senator, and I thank you for the opportunity. For me, I want to tell you, we have seen, and we do things at the Capitol as a team. Terry England, you are a great leader for the whole state of Georgia, and what you do for the budget and running the things for our fiscal responsibility, I want to thank you, Terry. Regina, I don't think there's ever been a smarter attorney in the world than your leadership in the House. And Tom Kirby, there's a straight shooter all the way home. Tom and I are actually fraternity brothers. Even though he's from Kentucky, we're both in an ag fraternity together. We found each other. Long lost brother Tom. Thanks for allowing me to be here tonight. I hope you enjoy your dinner. Terry told you I was going to tell you my phone number, and I am. So if you want to write it down, my cell phone number that rings right here on this cell phone is 706-680-4466. And if I can ever be of assistance to you at the Capitol, please call me. Let me know how I can help you. Thank you very much, Ginn.
Being here tonight, I'd like to thank my family, my lovely wife, and my two children that are here tonight. But I want to thank y'all for the support that you've given me and given the Sheriff's Office and the men and women who protect us in the community every day. I want to thank the Board of Commissioners who I work very closely with. I want to thank the local legislation that helps me through the Sheriff's Association. And I want to say to my very, very dear friend, Representative Quick, she said it right. We're in dire straits, ladies and gentlemen. This country is in dire straits. It's especially in dire straits for our public safety. Please, I ask that you pray for them every day. This group of people in this room support law enforcement. I know that. You're not the group that's attacking us. And we appreciate it. We appreciate the support that you give us. We appreciate the men and women who serve every day. I'd like to ask you for your support and your continued support in the coming weeks and the coming months, next year. Thank you very much, and God bless.
Now, I'm going to remember that part about working closely with the Board of Commissioners when it comes to budget time. They'll work it out. We appreciate all of them. Our main speaker tonight is first-term congressman from the 10th District. He won an interesting nomination process. If you remember, 2 years ago, we had, it seemed like umpteen candidates running for an open seat. Then we had a runoff, and finally Jody was our nominee, and he went on to victory. Took office in January this year. We're interested in these first 7 months and all the good stuff he can tell us in 20 minutes. Please give a warm welcome to our Congressman Jody Hice.
Thank you. Listen, I am deeply honored to be here with you. Many of you who are from Barrow County know that this is the county where everything changed for Dee Dee and myself. We were pastoring down here at Bethlehem First Baptist, and when the ACLU came after this county with the Ten Commandments, that was the beginning of a redefining period of time in our lives. And I just want to say publicly thanks to God, thanks to my incredible wife, Dee Dee, and thank you, Barrow County. Many of you have been on this journey since 2002. It started 2003 and got really cranked up. And it's just an incredible honor to serve you. Ken asked me to share with you a little bit about what's been going on the last 7 months in Washington. Let me just tell you this, the highlight of every week is getting on that plane, headed back to Georgia. I'll tell you that without any hesitation. I have come to love the smell of jet fumes like never before. In fact, I told someone on the House floor a few weeks back, we had had a particularly tough week with some hard votes and so forth, and everything just seemed to be upside down, as it frequently seems to be in Washington. But I was on the floor, and the last little bell rang. It was time for us to go home. And I don't even remember who was beside me, but I looked beside him, and I said, "Goodbye, Washington. I'm going back to America. Let me get home to Georgia." And I really, really mean that. But that is the highlight, coming home, which I do every weekend. But apart from that, the highlight, I would have to say, has been being a part of the House Freedom Caucus, which is a group of about 40 individuals who are the most conservative that we have in Congress. And y'all, I'm telling you, there is reason for hope. We meet them on the fly-in day every week. We have a meeting and we have a meal together, and I feel every week when I leave that group as though I've just left the presence of our founders. I mean, the spirit in that group and the courage and the commitment to our Constitution, to our founding principles, and to our system of government, and to take this country back is second to none. And it is absolutely an incredible honor to be a part of the House Freedom Caucus. I want to share with you a few experiences. People ask me frequently, what's been the biggest adjustment? What's been the biggest challenge? I will say this, and you'll probably notice this, my hair was a lot blacker about 7 months ago than it is now. But people ask me, what's the biggest challenge? And I would have to say this. Of course, I've been on the radio for about 12 years. I've been heavily involved in issues for a long time. But I never realized just how difficult some of the votes are. Some in here who have been involved politically for a long time can share with you. But y'all, I don't know how to say this to you, but just very honestly say, I agonize over many votes that we take. There are times that I sit in my office and I argue by myself, but there, I think out loud a lot. And there are times that I'm in my office and I argue why we need this bill, and it's got this, and it's got this, and it's got this, and it's going to help us move the needle. And then I turn right back around and start arguing why we don't need that bill, because it has this and this and this and this in it. And I can't tell you how many times I've sat back and then said to myself, what are you going to do now, Jody? We got to vote on this thing. What are we going to do? And so, you know, I just want you to know, that four-way test is the filter that we try to look at everything. Is it right? Is it constitutional? Is it something we really need? Is it something we can afford? And that filter is, we've instructed our staff to take everything through that filter. Let me give you a good example. It just happened right before we came home. There was a transportation bill. Some of you may know that the highway trust fund has gone broke. And so there was a bill to try to fund it for 3 months just to get through the summer. And they added some good stuff. And by the way, transportation is one of the 18 things that the Constitution actually says that Congress is to deal with. So this is a constitutional, clearly a constitutional issue. And they threw some other stuff in it for veterans and this, that, and the other. And it was a struggle. I ended up not voting for that bill, and I'll tell you why. 3 months, a 3 month bill to fund transportation was going to take us 7 years to pay off. 3 months. And what I know right now is 2 months from now, we're going to come back saying, all right, now we've got to fund this thing for next year. And that may take 15, 20, who knows how many years. And, you know, I sat back and said to myself, we need this. There's things in here for veterans that we need, but at the end of the day, this is fiscally irresponsible. We have got to cut spending. We are on the verge of an economic catastrophe in this country, and at some point, we have got to quit spending. We just can't go on and on and on with this battle. So I voted against that. And I voted. Hey, listen, you don't know how much I appreciate that. There's some transportation people who hate me and some others, but really that's the big. And a similar bill, I'll just give you this one other thing, then I want to transition to some other thoughts that I think will be of interest to you. But a similar one with an education bill that we recently had. The House Freedom Caucus, when we got started early, in fact, on and on, we faced a lot of ridicule, a lot of attacks from multiple ways, multiple different perspectives. But early, probably in February, they came up with an education bill that we were opposed to because it's just overall horrible. And ended up we had enough, and I'm saying we, conservatives, had enough to where they eventually pulled that bill and we never even voted on it. Well, here last month, it came up again. Oh, and the first time, there were members of the Freedom Caucus that submitted amendments to try to approve that bill, and all of our amendments that were submitted were ruled out of order, so they weren't even allowed to be considered. Well, now the bill comes up again last month, and we had four amendments. All four of them were ruled in order. All four of them were voted on the floor. Three out of the four actually passed. And it ended up being a much better bill than it was back in February. I still voted against it because it did not completely eradicate and do away with and toss in the trash can Common Core. But it was still a much better bill than what we had 3 or 4 months before. But let me just share with you a few things. Right out of the gate, in January, I told you that I would get behind the fair tax. I think the first thing I did was become an original co-sponsor of the fair tax. Also became a co-sponsor of a balanced budget amendment to the U.S. Constitution. Also became a co-sponsor of the bill for term limits and a host of other things. The very first bill that I introduced was the strongest, most conservative pro-life bill in the House of Representatives. It's the Sanctity of Human Life Act. It recognizes life begins at conception and ends at natural death. And that was the very first bill that I introduced, and I was very honored to be able to start with that. But it's been a tremendous learning curve, as you can imagine. We have an incredible staff. Some of you have even spoken to me tonight about the staff. We have, both in Washington and here in the district, an absolutely incredible staff. And I cannot imagine being in this position without having people who can help navigate through all of this stuff and help. And we've just got what I believe is the cream of the crop. We have, by the way, we have 18 positions that we can fill on our staff. We had over 3,000 resumes for those 18 positions. And I really believe that we got the cream of the crop. But with that, you know, basically as a freshman, you're told to sit down, shut up, and wait your turn. But we have really, and I give God credit, I give our staff a lot of credit, but we have had the opportunity to move forward on a lot of pretty significant things. To begin with, I'm very honored to be on two very important committees. One is Oversight and Government Reform. We call it OGR. That is the committee that Trey Gowdy also serves on, and all the investigations with Benghazi and all this kind of thing that you see. OGR is responsible for any and every agency, department, whatever of our government, where there is fraud, abuse, inefficiency. Those issues come before OGR, and we deal with it. And y'all, I cannot tell you how busy we have been, as you can imagine. We frequently have two hearings a day in OGR. In just 7 months now, we have had seven heads of departments that have been removed or forced to resign because of the work of OGR. The most recent, John Koskinen of the IRS. He actually has not yet resigned, but the last week of July before coming home, we had a press conference as a committee, and all of us spoke to the issue, demanding that the president remove Koskinen from that position, and that if the president does not remove him, we will begin impeachment proceedings against John Koskinen. This has to do with the lowest learner stuff and all the targeting of conservatives and conservative groups with the IRS, an absolutely huge, inexcusable scandal, and we're getting to the bottom of it. I also serve, and in that committee, I serve on subcommittees of national defense and healthcare. So I'm really blessed to be on some key issues there. And then on the second committee is natural resources, which deals with offshore drilling as well as anything that's a natural resource on our shores. And so I'm very, very blessed to be on those committees. Let me just hit this thought, because it's pretty unprecedented the favor that we've been able to have in 7 months. Even Fox News has done a special report on one of the bills that we put forward. And they're talking to us now about another one that we put forward. And y'all, I just tell you, that's unprecedented for freshmen even to have that kind of recognition from a national news agency. But to twice be seeing this is just amazing. And let me tell you what some of these are, some of the bills that we've moved. One is actually passed. We now have, it's a small deal probably for a lot of people, but it's law now that federal lands in Georgia and in the East can be used agriculturally for grazing purposes and so forth. And that is actually law right now. And we're grateful that we were able to push that through and glad for that. But some of the other things, we put forth a bill to deal with immigration. Right now, did you know a person can come into this country legally and then sponsor up to 273 other people? One person? And that's called chain migration. We introduced a bill that would put a stop to that and allow people to come into this country and sponsor their family. Another bill that we introduced that fell short by about 13 votes was a federal union bill. And this was actually the one that Fox News picked up on and did their special report on. But under the administration of Carter, there's a difference between a federal union and a typical union, auto workers union, for example. The typical union, they're able to pay their people who work for the union. A federal union is supposed to be volunteer. Well, back in the Carter administration, he opened the door a little bit so that federal union people can do small parts of federal work during their official time, wherever it is they're working. The VA, for example, let's say someone's working in the Veterans Administration and they are part of the federal union, they could go file a grievance, for example, during their official time. Well, that has grown and grown and grown and grown to the extent that now we have thousands of federal union workers who are working for our federal government, giving 100% of their time not to do the work that they were hired to do, but to do federal union activity. And all taxpayers are paying for them. Let's say a person was hired by the VA to work with our veterans. Hundreds of them in the VA are literally doing nothing. 100% of their time is doing union activity, but they're getting paid under VA paycheck on the backs of taxpayers. So we put a bill forward to put a stop to that. Came within about 13 votes of passing. It fell short, so we're going to continue pushing forward on that in as many different avenues as we can. The abuse is just insane, to the tune of billions of dollars that can be saved. Another bill recently that the national news has also expressed a lot of interest is called TRAC. It's another immigration bill. TRAC stands for Tracking Reoffending Alien Criminals. All of us have heard of the number of horrible crimes that are being committed in our country right now by illegals who are in this country. Here's the problem, and I was not aware of this until being in Washington, but did you know that our Supreme Court actually made the decision that if a person is in this country illegally and they commit a crime, a felony, and their country of origin does not want them back, which their country does not once they're a felon, Judge nodded his head, we talked to him about this bill. If their country of origin does not want them back, the Supreme Court ruled that we cannot keep a person who is not a citizen of the United States more than 6 months in jail. So these people are able to come and commit crimes, and we have to release them after 6 months. We came down hard on the Department of Homeland Security, and I'm really pleased that I got a phone call from them, Judge, saying that they are beginning to report in Georgia, specifically because of the questioning that I had with her, and I'm so honored. Y'all, these people were being released in counties all across our country. We didn't know who they were, where they were being released. We didn't know anything about them, and now we are. But TRAC specifically, my bill is going after sex offenders. It will require these people to be listed on the National Sex Offender Registry list. It will require the sheriff's departments, counties, and states will be notified who these people are, where they are released, where they live, so that we can at least keep track on them and know who they are and where they are, rather than just have them. And the last bill that I introduced a week before coming home is the Military Recruiter Right to Carry Act. That bill right now is in the House Armed Services Committee. We're hopeful that it will come out, but the intent of that is very obvious in light of the terrorist attack in Chattanooga. I think many people were stunned to realize that many of our military are not allowed to carry like private citizens are. And so our bill basically says that our military has the right to defend themselves just as much as any other private citizen in this country does, and they have the right to defend themselves in the recruiting offices. So hopefully, we're in process now of getting co-sponsors for that bill, and hopefully it'll come up. All right, here's where we're going, and I'll just close with this. September is going to be an extremely busy month. I'm probably will finish tonight reading the Iran deal. Oh, this is the most horrendous thing you've ever seen in your life. We're going to be dealing with it as soon as we get back in September. I was honored to be in the joint session with Benjamin Netanyahu. I've met with the Israeli ambassador to the United States. And in fairness, I've met with in briefings with John Kerry and others who actually put this deal together. And y'all, I'm here to tell you this bill has got to be this deal has got to be defeated. It is a disaster both in the United States and for Israel, and it paves the pathway for a nuclear race in the Middle East, the likes of which we have never seen before. And we've got to stop it. I feel confident that we will stop it with our party. What I'm questioning is whether or not we want to have the numbers to override a veto, because most certainly that's going to happen. So please, please keep us in your prayer, and please, if there is any way that you can put pressure on every congressman, people you know who live in other parts of our state and our country, please put pressure. This deal is a disaster, and we can't let it pass. That's coming up in September. We're also going to be dealing with Ex-Im Bank. We're also going to be dealing with the debt ceiling. We are also going to be dealing with Planned Parenthood. We are also going to be dealing with our First Amendment religious liberties right in light of the horrendous Supreme Court decision redefining marriage. We've got all of these things that are going to be right before us coming in September. It is going to be busy, and it's going to be very confrontational in every way imaginable. But I know that you know where I stand on these issues, and we'll be fighting hard every day and standing firmly on those positions. And I do just again want to thank you. I can't tell you. What's my time? I'm about up. Okay. Well, then I'll wrap it up. You know, when Ken says you're about up, that means you've stepped over the line. So wrap it up. Y'all, it's just an incredible honor to serve you, an incredible honor to be back here in Barrow County. We've got so many roots here, and we love you deeply, deeply. And it's my privilege to introduce the next speaker. First, Dee Dee and I first met Tim Echols about 25 years ago. Tim and Wendy, we've known him for a long time. And this is absolutely one of the most quality men on this planet. Just last week, I spoke to a group in Indian Springs, and I go down to this group, and it's led by Tim. It's a group of about 50 young men from all across the country where he is mentoring them and teaching them, training them to be leaders to take our country back. Tim has been involved not only politically, but in development and mentoring for years and years. And of course, he's one of our public service commissioners. I believe absolutely the best public service commissioner we've ever had in the state of Georgia. He is in this state fighting the EPA like nobody else. And so would you welcome, give a great Barrow County welcome to this platform, our public service commissioner, Tim Edwards.
Thank you. You know, don't you wish what happened in Washington stayed in Washington? But it's not the case, because when the president declared war on coal in 2007, he meant it. And he's about to bankrupt the coal industry in our country. One of the first votes that I took was whether or not to close Plant Branch down on Lake Sinclair. Some of you fish down there, you know the 1,000-foot smokestack I'm talking about. That coal plant's been down there a long time. And it was a 4-1 vote to close the plant. And I stand here today, and I hope you're not mad at me, but I voted to keep the coal plant open at Plant Branch. You know, the other thing that we got a little controversy on are these cell phones from the federal government. My colleague, Doug Everett, came up with the idea of charging all these folks that have these cell phones in Georgia, about 1.2 million of them, a $5 charge per month. And you would have thought we had stuck their mother in the eye with a stick. Because the lawyers came from Washington, they sued us. I had the state do an audit, and there were 112,000 of them with two of the phones in each pocket. And through scaring the phone companies to death, we cut those phones from about 1.2 million down to a 500,000 phones. So let's give a hand for Commissioner Everett and that great idea. But I tell you what really ticked me off was that EPA rule that the president released June 14th of last year. Of course, there's a record number of comments, 4.3 million comments submitted on this. And just a couple of Mondays ago, the president came out with the final version of the rule. You may have seen the press conference on Fox where he was bragging, basically paying off some, making good on some campaign promises that he had made to the environmental community. And, you know, here's what he said, and here's the issue that I take with the president. First of all, the president said that if America leads the way in climate change, the world will follow. You believe that? No. I mean, China nods and smiles. India nods and smiles, and they buy our coal. They're buying our coal. And China's building a coal plant every month. China's not cutting their CO2 substantially. China's building coal plants. We're the one bankrupting our coal industry here. So the president's misguided in thinking that these folks are going to follow his lead. I tell you what's going to happen. We're going to wind up with a net increase in CO2 because they're burning our coal and they're not being near as careful as we are. We're going to wind up with a net increase in CO2. The president said that if we don't act now, it will be too late. Did you hear him say that? That he said that the earth was fragile and that we needed to act. Really? Really? Georgia's cut our CO2 by 30% since 2005. We've cut mercury by 85%. We've cut NOx by 90%, SOx by 90%. These are real pollutants. And the president acts like that this is the biggest moral obligation that we've got. And we are the fastest growing solar state in the U.S. In quarter number one, we had the most clean energy jobs more than any other state, including California. So why do we need, Congressman, the federal government coming to us with these strict regulations when we're going in the right direction? We do not need them in our pocketbooks. They're only going to hurt our economy and run business off. But it's this comment about this moral obligation that bothers me the most. Now, you think about this. The federal government promised to pick up the nuclear waste that we had in our state. And we've been generating electricity, carbon-free, by the way, at our four reactors, two in Waynesboro, two down in Baxley. And the federal government has been charging me and you for the nuclear waste there, a tax, essentially. It's accumulated to about $1.2 billion. We finally sued and got it stopped. But here's what I'm saying, Mr. President. Before you talk to me about CO2, which our trees happen to really like down here, and we got 21 million acres of forest land, Mr. President, why don't you pick up that toxic nuclear waste sitting in our plant? That's what you've got a moral obligation to do, is pick up what you promised to pick up. I tell you what else you have a moral obligation to do, Mr. President, and it's balance the budget so that we are not putting in hock our children, our grandchildren, and our great-grandchildren forever. Mr. President, we need a balanced budget. This president has had record spending, and we can't get rid of it fast enough. I tell you what else we have a moral obligation to do, much more so than the CO2 at our plants, and that is taking care of our veterans at our veterans' facility. That's what you got a moral obligation to do, Mr. President. Instead of giving bonuses to the executives, Mr. President, let's take care of our men and women who have served our country. And finally, Mr. President, I think what you've got a moral obligation to do is to prosecute and defund Planned Parenthood, who are taking unborn children and dismembering them and selling their parts in the open market. Mr. President, this organization needs never get another penny from our tax coffers ever again. Well, my name is Tim Echols. I live in Athens, and in May, Barrow County will be campaign central for my campaign. We've rented Carmel Retreat over near the expressway. I'll have hundreds of young people in Barrow County stretching down into Gwinnett and other parts as we did in our last election, knocking on doors. And if you want to be a part of one of our teams, driving vans for our young people, as we knock on doors, not only for me, but for Johnny. We'll be working for Johnny as well, as these kids come from all over. So thank you for letting me serve you, and you can count on me to stand strong against the EPA and our federal government. Thank you.
Thank you, Kim. Our next speaker is also running for Public Service Commission. Maybe she's from Houston County. Please give a warm welcome to Michelle Miller.
Thank you very much for allowing me to speak tonight. I truly appreciate it. I just wanted to give you a little bit of information about me. First, I am a graduate of Penn State University. I have a degree in energy and sustainability policy. I did my energy research in Costa Rica. Also, I consulted internationally in the US, and I even won a military contract. Now, everyone probably here know what the PSC does, right? We regulate electric, natural gas, and telecommunications. But we do much more than that. We do three things. We are your financial investor and steward of your money. We advocate on your behalf, and we educate you. Can everyone do me a favor? Can you just raise your hand for me? Can everyone in the room raise your hand? I'm gonna get down a little bit, if you don't mind. I want you to repeat after me. Can you say, can you say, I am a shareholder? I really want you to say it like you mean it. Can you say, I am a shareholder?
I am a shareholder.
Thank you. I want you to personalize the PSC like you do your own money, because it is your money. Every single time you pay taxes, every single time that you pay that electric bill, you are investing in the state of Georgia, and you're investing in the PSC. And that gives you rights. One of the problems is that you're not informed. No one is telling you what the choices are, the consequences for those choices, whether it's positive or negative. So I said that we are financial stewards of your money. We need to make sure that every single time we make an investment for you, that we have a positive return. And if we don't, there's a risk-sharing mechanism written into the contract to protect you. And that hasn't happened, has it? If you look at Vogtle 3 and Vogtle 4, it's predicted that we're going to be negative $300 million in ratepayer benefit. That's you. What we thought was an investment where your electric bills were being decreased is going to increase almost $300 if you're a Georgia Power customer, between $400 and $500 or up if you're an EMC customer. And that's a problem. We need to levelize those scales so that we can regulate the companies that we protect and serve, just like we want to protect and serve you. And the problem is this. Everyone is looking for me to say I hate Georgia Power or I like Georgia Power, and really it has nothing to do with emotion. Because Georgia Power is a private company. They have an ethical responsibility to protect their shareholders' investment. So the problem isn't with Georgia Power, it's with us. Because we are supposed to protect your investment and we're not doing so. So the second thing we do is advocate. I understand that we're upset with the EPA. Same thing, I don't care about the EPA, one way or another. What I'm fighting for is, when is the Republican Party going to fight from a position of strength? We haven't done that. Look at the Clean Air Plan. Last time, we didn't comply for 2 or 3 years, and they withheld federal funding. Did we make a plan for that lost funding? No. And we suffered. Our bridges and our roads and our highways, we didn't have the money for it, right? No matter if we comply comply, or if we don't comply, we need to create a sound plan to make sure that we are fighting in a position of strength. And that's why I'm advocating for you. Second thing is this, when we create laws, sometimes those laws are not as efficient as we think they are, like the HB 57 solar leasing bill or solar financing bill. What's happening with that is now the EMCs, potentially they can charge you if you have a fee, if you have a solar panel in your house or in your business. So what did I do? I just partnered with Yanmar, a CHP manufacturer here in Georgia in Adairsville. We're creating a residential and commercial CHP pilot program. What will that do? It's going to diversify the EMCs. It's going to stop the EMCs from charging you that fee. It's going to make sure that we put downward pressure in EMC territory so that your rates won't increase as much. What would the benefit be for you? If you're a business and you're participating in the pilot program, now your electricity cost is fixed. If you're an apartment complex participating in the pilot program, now the single payer option, because in most EMC territories, they deal with disadvantaged families. And most people don't pay their bills on time. So now, if you're in an apartment complex, your electricity can be rolled into your rent, and the apartment manager or development company writes one check to the EMC. That's progress. That's protecting you. And lastly, we educate. We are trained to think that energy is only about having cheap and affordable energy. And that's not true. Electricity only travels between 250 to 300 miles on that electric line, and it loses kilowatts every single time. So no matter how much we invest in electricity and put it on the grid, we are going to consume it just as fast. So we must educate not only how to maximize, you know, that energy efficiency you have in your home when you consume that kilowatt, but we also have to teach you how to minimize how much you pay for that. Both cheap, affordable energy and energy efficiency goes hand in hand. And we need to start teaching you that in your community. And what I want to say lastly is this. When you think of a candidate, when you think of an incumbent who's running for a position that's this important, I'm going to challenge you to ask them, what is the future that they see for you in your county and in your state? You know what the future I see here in Georgia? Has anyone ever heard of Uber? You know what Uber is, right? So every time, the reason why Uber is so great is every time that car is sitting in your garage, it's idle, right? And you're not making any money. So Uber comes along, and now you can actually put that car into work and make money. Well, you know what? Your house is idling when you're not in it. And one day, we're going to develop micro grids throughout every county in Georgia. And one day, your commissioner can notify you in an app where you can check and say, you know what? We need 10,000 kilowatts right now. And then you can sign up and say, okay, I'm going to turn on my house because we have the technology now. I'm going to turn on my house, I'm going to let it produce energy, and I'm going to fulfill the need that we have in our county. We can do that. We have the technology to do that. That's what I see in our future. A smaller government where we're actually participating and partnering together to build a great Georgia and a great Barrow County. Thank you very much.
Thank you much. Our next speaker is our second vice chair of the state party. I'm going to ask Debbie McCord to come on up. She has an announcement involving a Second Amendment event that's coming up, and it's very important. Please give a warm welcome, Debbie McCord.
Thank you. Okay. First of all, can everybody hear me? Okay. One thing I want to say is first of all, let's give a shout out to Lynn. give our young military personnel who stopped a disaster yesterday in France. All of our young military men and women. And it's great to be back in the 10th District. I have spent most of my political career in the 10th District until they did that last week. Okay, I spent most of my political career in the 10th District until this last redistricting when they needed to get rid of John Barrow, so they moved me into the 12th. And my dad was actually the chairman of the 10th District for a number of years, so this is like coming home for me, so I'm very glad to be here. But I want to talk to you about some flyers I put out on some of the tables. Saturday, October 24th, there is no Georgia game that day, okay? So no excuses. We, the Georgia Republican Party, is having a Second Amendment celebration at a place called Wild Bill's in Duluth. It will hold around 5,000 people. So it's going to be a grand time. And some of you in here are old enough to remember the Manuel sisters, like I do. And Irving was the prettiest of the three of them, and she's going to be there, along with Keith Graham Brown and Bo Davidson. So we're estimating the ticket cost to be about $25 a person. Hope that you will be there, and we look forward to your support. And being here from Augusta, I look forward to hosting everybody in Augusta for the State Convention next year.
Thank you, Debbie. Our final speaker tonight is a dear friend of Bexar County, former state senator. Mike and I worked on his first campaign, and a lot can be said about it. And yeah, I didn't think he was going to win, but I sure am glad he did. He is our current Secretary of State. Please give a warm welcome, Mr. Brian Kemp.
Thank you, Ginn. Great to be with you all. I appreciate the opportunity to be back in Barrow County and certainly appreciate all the support that this county has given me over the years. I don't know about y'all, but after hearing all those speeches and the complex issues our congressman's dealing with and the other folks, I'm a little confused, but let me simplify things. The road to the White House is going to go through Georgia. Now, I want y'all to know you can thank your great local delegation for that. The legislature years ago had the foresight to give the Secretary of State's office the ability to set the date of our presidential preference primary, and that's really what started all this. It allowed us as a state to stay flexible on when we were going to pick our date versus having the legislature do it years ago. They are so efficient that they adjourned earlier than most legislatures across the country. And what would happen in years past is other big states like New York or California would end up going the same day as Georgia, and we're overshadowed. And the only time you hear about a presidential candidate coming to Georgia is when they fly into a fundraiser in Atlanta, and then you'll hear about the next day that they raised so much money and then they left. And I've been working for a long time to try to figure out a way that Georgia really matters in the race. And I maneuvered the state in 2008 into a pretty good position, but we still weren't quite as relevant as I wanted us to be for two reasons. Number one, everybody knew that Newt was going to win the race, you know, a couple of weeks out, so we didn't get quite as many visits because we had a hometown candidate. But also, I wanted to, you know, after that, I started thinking, what else could we do to make us more relevant? And I came up with the whole strength in numbers idea, that if we could get some other southern states to go the same day as us, we'd have a big enough delegate count in the South that basically would force the candidates to spend time here. So over 2 years ago, I came up with this idea of this regional primary, which got dubbed the SEC primary. And I started working with states like Alabama, Mississippi, Arkansas, Tennessee, and others to make sure that everybody set their date on March the 1st. And we announced that early, so the rest of the country, the campaigns, all these people that were paying attention would realize that. And after a lot of work, we ended up getting seven different states to all go the same day. And I think you've all seen the fruits of that labor with the candidates that we've had coming through here. But I'll tell you a really funny story, and what is one of the turning points of us starting to get national press and really getting on the radar of the presidential candidates in the campaigns. There was a reporter from the Boston Globe that came down during the session, and he said, we want to do an article about how the people in Manchester, New Hampshire, which is the first primary in the country, and they always have a big influence in the presidential race and decide who the front runner is going to be. Well, we want to interview people in Manchester, Georgia, because they're going to be just as important as people in Manchester, New Hampshire, because of this regional primary. So this reporter came down, and we helped them get some good Republican folks together down there in Manchester, Georgia, and they talked to this reporter about how excited they were about the race and how they were looking forward to it. Then they came up to the Capitol and met with me and the governor and the speaker and interviewed some other political people up there. And then that article was on the front page of the Boston Globe back last week. And that's what really started getting people talking about this. And it's really just been a landslide since then. And y'all know about all the candidates that have come. The one interesting thing that reporter said when he got back from Manchester, he came into office because he wanted to interview me about the whole process too. And we asked him, said, you know, how'd it go in Manchester, Georgia? And this is a guy from Boston, right? Oh, he said, oh, it's great. Well, those people are really excited. And Congressman, you'll like this. But he said, you know what? They got a lot of churches and a lot of guns down there. I told him, welcome to Georgia. So I thought that was pretty funny. But it's really been amazing to see the number of candidates that came through the Capitol this session, spoke to the legislature, was meeting with groups privately. You know, after that, having three presidential candidates at our state convention, that was unbelievable. You know, John Kasich doing a lunch with the Fulton County Republican Party, speaking at Roy's Barbecue in Walton County, and then the Red State event where we had nine presidential candidates in our state the day after and 2 days after the first debate. So literally, all the talk of the presidential race the day after and 2 days after the debate happened right here in Georgia in the heart of the SEC primary. And normally, even if that Red State event had have been in Georgia, normally those candidates would have come in and spoken and they would have left. But because of the SEC primary, many of them stayed, went to other parts of the state, you know, Perry, Savannah, Noonan, had, you know, lunches at barbecue restaurants where you could go and visit with them and ask them questions. Did meetings in Atlanta with big groups of people. And that's really what I envisioned, is for you all to have a voice in this process, which we should. We've got the fourth largest amount of delegates on the Republican side of this presidential race. So you all absolutely should have a say-so in this race. And so should our state. You know, everybody knows about ethanol subsidies, right? You know why? Because the race starts in Iowa. And that's where the corn is, and that's where all the ethanol is. So regardless of what side of the issue you're on, everybody knows about it. Well, with the presidential race coming through Georgia and the South, they're going to know about the good things that our legislature is doing, like balancing the budget every year. They're going to know about our fast-growing port that we have, the new cybersecurity and the great military bases we have in our state. You know, our world's busiest airport, just all those things that make Georgia great. And the things that we're doing, you know, everybody talks about the Midwestern governors and the great things that they've done, and a lot of them have done some really great things, and I know many of you in the room are supporting some of those governors. But those are things that we've been doing in the South for years. So it is fitting and right that the race should come through here and let us have a voice, because I believe our country will be better for it. And I hope y'all will enjoy it as much as I have. Thank you very much for that.
Round for all of our speakers. Does everybody have a ticket? It's time for some door prizes. Now I asked Tammy, Lynn, we might need some help. We need some volunteers. Get some volunteers. Very good. We're going to do our drawings for door prizes next, and then we'll get to the big contest. First of all, I appreciate all the donations. here, the winning number, start off right, even number, 500. Who's got number 500? Number 500. You must be present to win. 500 going once. There we have a winner, right over there, please. Very good, very good. Our next door prize is a scarf, number 484. Number 484. It's not that hard, it's on your ticket. Number 484. Going once, going twice, loser! The next winning number is 133. 133. Where's our winner? Let's do the elephant. We gotta get the elephant next. The elephant is number 13. What's number 13? Who's got number 13? We have a winner down to this table. Where's the elephant? Next door prize is a patriotic candle, number 308. 308. Going one.
Raise your hands so we can see. Thank you. Another
number 53. Number 53. Well, Governor. I'm going to have to go down. A 2FIT cup set, winning number is number 258. 258. 258. 258 from Vermont. Only three times. Loser. The next winning number is number 309. Number 309, right here on the end. And that's it? Very good. Thank you so much, ladies. Appreciate you. Now, we come to that time for our contest award presentation. And we have to mention to you that this is an historic first. We have a four-way tie for the correct answer. And since I only have one gift card, I'm just going to pick at random one of these up here. And the winner of the prize, by the way, the winning number was 2076. Hopefully our country can survive to our 300th birthday. 2076 is the winning number, and believe it or not, with a winning number of 2016, B. Bob Smith. He asked me what the number was, and I wouldn't tell him. Just make a good guess of it. And now for the poll results.
No man did vote.
We don't charge for our strong poll because we don't want to get a good snapshot of everybody that's here. The winner of the 2016 Republican Party strong poll in Barrow County with 21 votes is Donald Trump. Yes. In second place with 16 votes is Ted Cruz. In fourth place, with 9 votes, Kirby Fiorina. In fifth place, with 3 votes, is Mike Huckabee. And in sixth place, Rand Paul with 2 votes. We have a 4-way tie for 7th, with 1 vote each. Jeb Bush, Chris Christie, John Kasich, and undecided. Now, here's hoping that we break tradition, because we have said before, if the rest of the country would do like Barrow County, we wouldn't be in the mess we're in today. But every time we pick a good nominee, and the top three here are really great, they never seem to go to win the nomination. This year's got to be different. We've got to get a good conservative as our nominee. Listen, we appreciate you being here tonight. I can't tell you how much we appreciate your support for the local party. We had a great time. I hope that you had a good time. And if you have any suggestions on how to improve things, we're certainly open to it. I do want to mention this, and this is very important. Our next regular meeting is Monday, September the 21st. We meet in the Wine and Romans Club. And it is our honor to have State School Superintendent Richard Woods with us. We designated the school board tonight. Come out and see Superintendent Woods and see your school board members. We're going to make it their night, September the 21st. We will need help on cleanup, so if you can help a little bit with us, we appreciate it. Thanks for coming tonight.